Good morning and welcome to this service of worship. I'm Paige McRight, privileged to be the interim pastor here at Oakland Church, and we are delighted that you have chosen to worship with us this morning. There are several announcements I want to call to your attention. First is that we will have a congregational meeting on Zoom at 12:30, and every active member who is eligible to vote should have received this week a link to that Zoom meeting. If you didn't receive a link and you're an active member of the church, please indicate that in the chat, and Stacy Gillespie, who is watching, will send you a link. We know that there's been some internet outage today through CenturyLink. If we don't have enough members to have a quorum for the meeting at 12:30, the meeting will be postponed until next week. The September newsletter goes out tomorrow with details on upcoming events in the life of the church, different activities that are beginning, a different kind of stewardship season that begins next week. You'll want to read your newsletter carefully and pay attention to all of those features in it that are important for you and your ministry here. We want to thank everyone who signed up to take part in music ministry, in online Sunday school, for children, in the men's prayer breakfast, and all of the studies that are coming up. It's clear that we have figured out here how to be a community online, and that's a great thing for now. If you want to contribute to the relief effort in Louisiana and Arkansas in the wake of Hurricane Laura, there are many ways to do that. One is to go to the General Assembly website, pcusa.org. Their homepage has a link for where you can contribute to hurricane relief. That concludes the morning announcements, except to say that the beautiful flowers on the lectern are given by Stephanie Berry in honor of her family. Thank you.
Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Yes, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Jordan River, chilly and cold, it chills the body but not the soul. There is but one train upon this track. It runs to heaven and right back. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Yes, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. I will pray. I will pray.
Let's call ourselves to worship using the words of Psalm 37, I believe. I didn't put it in this week, so those of you who are reading the Psalms with me through until Christmas, check me. I think it's Psalm 37 this week. Let's call ourselves to worship together. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him.
The salvation of the righteous is from the Lord.
He helps them and rescues them.
Because they take refuge in him.
Let us worship God. Our hymn is God Whose Giving Knows No Ending, hymn 422 in the blue hymnal.
God God who's giving knows no ending from your rich and endless shore. Nature's wonder, Jesus' wisdom, costly cross, grave shattered door. Gifted by you, we turn to you, offering up ourselves as wise. Thankful song shall rise forever, gracious donor of our days. Skills and times are ours for pressing towards the goals of Christ your Son. All at peace in health and freedom, races joined, the church made one. Now direct our daily labor, lest we strive for self alone. Born with talents, make us servants fit to answer at your throne. Treasure too you have entrusted, gained through powers your grace conferred. Ours to use for home and kindred, and to spread the gospel word. Open wide our hands in sharing, as we heed Christ's ageless call. Healing, teaching, and reclaiming, serving you by loving all.
Scripture tells us that if we say we have no sin, we are strangers to the truth. But if we confess our sin, God, who is merciful, stands ever ready to hear and to forgive. In that assurance, let us confess our sin to God this morning using the corporate prayer of confession that you'll see on the screen. Lord, we talk about faith, but hesitate to live it. We talk about love, but do not put it into action. We are afraid to turn the other cheek, to walk the extra mile, to say what we know to be the gospel truth. Sometimes we are empty words. Make us like Christ, your living word made flesh. Give us the courage of our convictions so that we too may, what we do, may be proof of what we say, through the grace of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Amen.
Rejoice and be glad. Blessed are you. Holy are you.
Good morning. At this time, I'd like to invite the children and the children at heart to come a little bit closer to the screen for the children's sermon. But before you sit down, or if you've already sat down, I'd like for you to stand up. Want to play a quick game of Simon Says, kind of get you out of your seat. If you don't know how to play it, I will say Simon Says, followed by an action that you'll do. But you only do it if you hear Simon Says. Okay? Ready? Here we go. Simon says, touch your nose. Simon says, jump up and down. Simon says, scratch your head. Touch your chin. Oh, Simon didn't say. I'm sure there's probably some of you out there that didn't do it. Okay, one more. Simon says, pat your head while rubbing your belly. I like to see. There's some here at the church who are doing that. I'd love to see. It would be fun to see some of you others doing it. Well, what makes this game so much fun, it was always a favorite of mine as a child, is a good leader for it. Someone to show how it's done and to have fun. But also, it was fun when that person would pass on the job of being Simon to someone else, add some extra fun. Well, friends, today, after service, we will be electing leaders for our church. We'll also be electing a group of folks who will have the important job of searching for our next pastor. Being a leader is an important job. And so I wonder what you think makes a good leader. If you printed out your worksheet that was sent out in the Friday news, there's a line in there where you can add your list of what you think makes a good leader. I'd be interested to find out what you put. I found an article recently where a group of second graders, kind of like yourself, were asked the same question. They were asked, when thinking about a leader, what characteristics and traits this leader should have to get the job done well? And here's a list of some of the characteristics they came up with. Listen closely and see if it matches your list. A leader should be brave, kind, encouraging, helpful, responsible, hardworking, and smart. I wonder if you would add anything to that list. I know I would add that a leader, especially one in the church, should follow, pray, and listen to God. This is what Jesus did, and he's a pretty good example, one of the best, of being a great leader. And another thing, leaders also need people to pray for them. And that's an important job you can do, we can all do. And we can pray that they will make good decisions and they will follow and listen to God. We can do that right now. Will you join me in an echo prayer? Dear God, thank you for all those who say yes to the important job of being a leader. Help them to make good decisions and listen to you. Help me to always remember to pray for them. Amen.
As we turn to God's word, please pray with me. God, in every age, you call leaders.
Pray for them.
To guide your people. We pray for those called to leadership in our church. And we pray that you will inform us as well as inspiring us through your word this day, that all the opportunities for leadership you give us will be opportunities where we can lead as we follow you. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our scripture reading today is from John chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. Now, when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard, "Jesus is making and baptizing more disciples than John," although it was not Jesus himself, but his disciples who baptized, he left Judea and started back to Galilee, but he had to go through Samaria. So he came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son, Joseph. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This week we are all about looking to the future. Following the service, as Tiffany has reminded us, you will elect ruling elders and deacons to 3-year terms, except for one deacon who's fulfilling an unexpired term. And you will elect the Congregational Nominating Committee for the classes of 2021. And you will elect a Pastor Nominating Committee. Today, you are shaping the tomorrows of all of those whose lives are touched by the ministry of this church. It's important work. It's not the only work you do in your ministry, but it's important work. Having worked now for 3 full months with your session and your deacons, I'd say that you all tend to choose very wisely. The ruling elders you have elected make their decisions with wisdom and with courage. The deacons you have elected carry out their ministry with compassion and love. That's just what you want. Your wise choices mean that the community around you find in this church a place of welcome, a place of hospitality for community events that stretch from being a voting place to being a gathering place for Boy Scouts, a place where an AA group meets, a preschool that nurtures children in their growth, in finding their gifts for service in God's world, and many, many other things that I don't even know about yet. You have a reputation of being a church that opens its doors and its arms to support this community. And the people who come here to worship find a welcome and often find a home. You do well in electing leaders and in your ministry. The text for this week offers us just a brief glimpse, because it's a brief text, of leadership in Jesus' time. John the Baptist has been drawing crowds to be baptized in the Jordan. Jesus' disciples have taken up the work of baptism. The Pharisees, those leaders of the Jews who are even more interested in doing things decently and in order than Presbyterians are very nervous. John, with his wild animal skins and even wilder hair, John, who is proclaiming a baptism of repentance, may well be competing with the orderly procession of people to the temple to offer their sacrifices in atonement for sin. Word has come to the Pharisees that Jesus is baptizing, though in fact it's Jesus' disciples who are doing the baptizing. The work of ministry is breaking out all over, and the Pharisees are scared. You may have recognized when Lee read our text that this is the beginning of the story of Jesus and the Samaritan woman. That is a wonderful story of a time when Jesus made one woman's tomorrows different from her past. But that's a story for another day. You will want to be back for that one, but today we are focusing on Jesus' style of leadership, which is the teaching and encouraging and challenging and giving away ministry style of leadership that calls others into service as well. He has said to the disciples, you've seen John baptize, at least I think he has, it's not in the text. It's a cleansing from sin, a faith-deepening thing as you reassure people of God's grace and forgiveness. You go baptize too. He's giving away that part of the ministry he's shaping. He's shaping the tomorrows of the disciples who will be his witnesses. I want to suggest to you today that Jesus, in this little text, shows us what leadership in the church is all about. This model for shared ministry that we see in John 4 is the model we follow in the Presbyterian church today, even though we may not be aware of it at any given moment. In our book of order in chapter 2 of government, it says that the church's ordered ministries described in the New Testament and maintained by this church are deacons and presbyters. That's ministers of word and sacrament, or also called teaching elders, and ruling elders. Ordered ministries are gifts to the church to order its life, so that the ministry of the whole people of God may flourish. The existence of these ordered ministries in no way diminishes the importance of the commitment of all members to the total ministry of the church. What we now call ordered ministries, we used to call offices, and there's a reason we changed it. Clubs elect officers to lead them for a time and then step down and let somebody else lead. That's not what we do when we ordain people. Ordination is for life. Now, there is a provision in the Book of Order for people to lay aside their ordination if the circumstances of their own life are such that they feel they cannot serve. It may be that there's a desire to change to another denomination. It may be that there's something going on personally, morally, that they have to wrestle with. And so they lay aside their ordination. There's also provision, as you might expect, because the Book of Order tries to cover everything we do, that the session can say of a deacon or an elder, you need to step down from office. We are removing office from you for a time so that they can straighten out things in their life that are causing distress, are causing them to need to step away from leadership. Though that happens very, very seldom in the life of the church. Ordinarily, once a person is ordained, that person is ordained for life. That's why when we proceed to installation, you will next month notice that the elders elected, if you elect the nominees given to you by the nominating committee today, will be installed but not ordained. They've all already been ordained and have served as elders before. Four of the five deacons have never served in the office of deacon in the Presbyterian Church, and so they will be ordained. Did you notice when I read to you from the Book of Order what it says about the purpose of ordered ministry? It's to order the life of the church so that the ministry of the whole people of God may flourish. The existence of ordered ministries in no way takes away from your responsibility to share your gifts in the ministry of the church. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians that there are different gifts, and gifts are given to each of us for the common good, which I think also can be translated to be used in our shared ministry. We're all in this together, this ministry business, with different talents that make our shared ministry much richer because we bring different gifts. And we are given to each other to support each other in ministry, to keep learning and growing and serving together. So I want to say a word to you about what deacons and elders are called to do. This is way more an information sermon than an inspiration sermon, but I just think it's a good idea to reflect on what we're doing when we have an election. Deacons, according to the Book of Order, are like this. The ministry of the deacon is set forth in Scripture is one of compassion, witness, and service. Persons of spiritual character, honest repute, exemplary lives, brotherly and sisterly love, sincere compassion, and sound judgment should be chosen for this ministry. Elders are defined like this. As there were in Old Testament times elders for the government of the people, so the New Testament church provided persons with particular gifts to share in discernment of God's Spirit and governance of God's people. Accordingly, the congregation should elect persons of wisdom and maturity of faith, having demonstrated skills in leadership and being compassionate in spirit. Ruling elders are so named not because they lord it over the congregation, but because they are chosen by the congregation to discern and measure its fidelity to the Word of God and to strengthen and nurture its faith and life. So you see, the work of elders as leaders goes all the way back to the Old Testament, all the way back to the time of Moses. People recognized that they needed people to be appointed, to be elected, to govern, to make community life possible. However, the same paragraph points out to those ruling elders, lest they get the big head and be haughty, that they are ruling not in the sense of having a scepter so they can lord it over the people, but in the sense of being like a measuring stick, a ruler that measures the faithfulness of the congregation to the Word of God and also nurtures its faith and life. Sound judgment for deacons and wisdom and maturity for elders and compassion for both. That's what you're looking for when you elect people to lead you. With regard to the congregation's nominating committee, the Book of Order says that you are to elect people from among your own active membership to discover who God will call next year to serve terms on the session and the diaconate. All three of these groups are people you elect every year, and when we gather in a little while for that election, you'll hear names for all three positions together, and you'll be invited to elect them in one vote. The congregation's pastor nominating committee is a much less frequent election. The Book of Order says about it that when there is a pastoral vacancy because the previous pastor has retired or has accepted another call, the session shall call a congregational meeting to elect a pastor nominating committee that shall be representative of the whole congregation. The committee's duty shall be to nominate a pastor for election by the congregation. The work of a pastor nominating committee takes a while. They need to get input from you about the strengths that you see in this congregation and the places you believe this church needs to grow stronger to be an effective witness in the world around us, here and now. Because we are in the midst of a pandemic and we cannot gather in small groups to have those conversations, your session has determined that we will use an online tool that is used in many places during an interim period. It's called a congregational assessment tool. And some of you will be invited to give your assessment in that way so that the pastor nominating committee can have a look at what you all think are the strengths and the areas for growth in this church. In addition to that, the pastor nominating committee needs demographic information. Travis has already put together a Google map of where you all live, and sent it to me, and surprise to me, you are a regional church. There are members of this congregation, people in this congregation, who live all over the Orlando area. You are a regional church, not a small town church anymore. I'll be doing some more demographic research for you and for the committee, and when I'm done, I will invite us on another Sunday after church to gather on Zoom and let me show you slides of what the demographics show about the community where we are. We'll also have a different Sunday to hear the reports on the strengths and the areas for growth that you see. We have more to do so that the committee, when it comes to write up the description of this church to be circulated among ministers who are interested in a call, can do the best job possible describing both who you are and where God has planted you to serve in ministry. Once they've done that, and the Committee on Ministry has approved their statement, it will be put on the General Assembly website, and it will be matched with ministers whose gifts and talents seem to be a good fit with your needs and wants in your next pastor. In addition to that, it'll be up on the General Assembly website where any minister who is open to a call, any Presbyterian minister who is open to a call can see it. And there will be ministers who will refer themselves to your committee for consideration. In addition to that, in your travels, you may attend a different Presbyterian church, or in your exploration on the internet, you may attend a different Presbyterian church and there see pastors who you think might be a good fit for this church. And you're encouraged to let the committee know who those people are. If I were a betting woman, I would bet that your committee will have over 200 names to consider when it's all said and done. That's a lot. And sorting through all those resumes to discern in the midst of them the person God is calling to be your next install pastor will take a while. While that's going on, you have three jobs with regard to the search process. The first job is to pray frequently and fervently for your pastor nominating committee. The second job is to listen attentively and carefully every time they report to you on their progress, either through the newsletter or in an in-person report during a worship service. They'll do both, I think, but they'll do it when they have made a step further along in the process to let you know. The third job, I tell you out of my years of experience working on presbytery staffs, never, ever, ever, ever ask for names or clues about who they're considering. You may have your own favorite pick you want to be sure is on the list. Don't ask. You may just be curious to know who they're thinking about. Don't ask. Am I clear? I'll tell you why. I'm sure you're wondering. Three times in my time of serving on the staff of four different presbyteries, I've had ministers call me and ask me to tell the Committee on Ministry that they are taking their name out of consideration because word has gotten back to their congregation that they're seeking another call. If they're not picked, questions have been raised in their home church that they don't need to deal with. Don't do that to yourselves and to your committee. Instead, pray for them, listen to them, and trust God to be at work in them to find the person God is calling to be your next installed pastor. Today, you have some jobs to do that are important for leadership in your church. You are shaping the tomorrows of your church and of a minister and minister's family. You are shaping the tomorrows of all those who whose lives are touched by the witness of this congregation. We are all in this together, supporting one another every day in our ministries. Today, you elect the people you trust to lead you so that your ministry and the ministry of this whole people of God can flourish to glorify God, make disciples, and change the world. Amen. Our hymn is, "I'll Go Where You Want Me to Go."
It may not be on the mountain's height, or over the stormy sea. It may not be at the battlefront my Lord will have need of me. But if by a still small voice he calls to paths that I do not know, I'll answer, dear Lord, with my hand in thine, I'll go where you want me to go. I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord, over mountain or plain or sea. I'll say what you want me to say, dear Lord. I'll be what you want me to be. Perhaps today there are loving words which Jesus have made to speak. There may be now in the paths of sin some wanderer whom I should seek. O Savior, if thou wilt be my guide through dark and our rugs the way, my voice shall echo the message sweet. I'll say what you want me to say. I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord, over mountain or plain or sea. I'll say what you want me to say, dear Lord. I'll be what you want me to be. There's surely somewhere a lonely place in a harvest field so wide, where I may labor through a life's short day for Jesus the crucified. So trusting my all to the tender care, and knowing thou lovest me, I'll do thy will with a heart sincere. I'll be what you want me to be. I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord, over mountain or plain or sea. I'll say what you want me to say, dear Lord. I'll be what you want me to be.
Now let us affirm our faith using the ancient words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. So you see why it was my father's favorite hymn. And I'm glad that this week we got to hear it. Thank you. Let's pray together. Gracious God, you call us to life in community together and bless us richly with talents and love so that the work of your church is a blessing and a gift in our lives and in the lives of many. We are grateful. Especially we are grateful for your Son, our Savior, who gave his life that we might know life abundant now and always. In the face of hurricanes, we are grateful that if storms come to us, this church can provide a temporary shelter for our neighbors in need. We lift before you those whose lives have been dramatically altered this week in the wake of Hurricane Laura. And pray for those whose homes were damaged or destroyed, for those who were injured, for those who lost loved ones and mourn. Send your comfort into their hearts, we pray, and into their lives through the work of those who help with restoration and healing. We pray for all who are ill in our congregation, for those who are recovering from illness and surgery, and we pray your healing mercy for them. We rejoice at this week's news that the spread of the virus seems to be slowing in Florida and here in Orange County. And we promise to continue to take care to help stem the spread. We pray for the safety of students and staff in schools and colleges, that safe practices will protect them from illness. We pray for all facing economic hardship for any reason in this time, especially for those whose work has been impacted by the COVID crisis. And we pray that new opportunities may be quickly found in this state, which has one of the fastest growing job growth rates in the country. Lord, we know that life is not always fair or just. And we pray that you will draw especially close to all who are in particular need of your comfort and the assurance of your faithful love, which never fails. In the midst of conflict, we pray for peace. In the midst of anxiety, we pray for calm. We pray that you will move in the hearts of people everywhere, especially those in places of authority, to work for justice and for wholeness for all. All this we pray in the name of Christ, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Worship God as we present our gifts, our tithes and offerings. The ways to give are on the screen, either online or by texting or by mailing in your offering. We are grateful to all of you for your generous support, which has continued to be strong through the summer months this year. If you've already given, give regularly online and do not need to do that at this time, we pray that you will pray, thanking God for your talents and offering them in God's service as well.
Everywhere I go, the Lord is near me. If I call upon him, he will hear me. Never will I fear, for the Lord is near everywhere I go. In the dark of night, should things alarm me, ever in his sight, no ill may harm me. I will be of cheer, for the Lord is near everywhere I go. He is with me day by day. He will be my strength and stay. From his path I will not stray, but follow in his way. In the coming days of joy or sadness, I will praise his name with songs of gladness. For to me it's clear that the Lord is near everywhere I go. Everywhere I go, the Lord is near me. If I call upon him, he will hear me. Never will I fear, for the Lord is near everywhere I go. In the dark of night, should things alarm me, ever in his sight, nor ill may harm me, I will be of cheer, for the Lord is near everywhere I go. He is with me day by day. He will be my strength and stay. From his path I will not stray, but follow in his way. In the coming days of joy or sadness, I will praise his name with songs of gladness. For to me it's clear that the Lord is near everywhere I go. For to me it's clear that the Lord is near everywhere I go. Bless the gifts our hands have brought, and bless the work our hearts have planned. Ours is the faith, the will, the thought. The rest, O God, is in your hand.
Gracious God, we dedicate to you these our gifts and ourselves your servants. Use us to fulfill the ministry you have for us through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our closing hymn is Go With Us, Lord. And now go out into the world in peace to love and serve the Lord. Go to live so that all those whose lives touch yours know something of the love and mercy of Christ. And if you're an active member of this congregation, don't go far, because remember, shortly we have a meeting together. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you and remain with you this day and always. Amen.